Hello and welcome to another edition of The Front Page. My name is Andrew McKeever, the managing editor of the Manchester Journal, and I'll be your host today. And today it's our pleasure to have here at the studios of GNAT two of our local state representatives with us. To my left is Cynthia Browning, a Democrat who represents Arlington, Sunderland, Sandgate, and West Rupert. And to my right is Jeff Wilson, Democrat who represents the town of Manchester. Cynthia, Jeff, real pleasure to have you with us today.
Great to be here. Thank you.
Great to be here. Thank you.
Initially, we had hoped to have all four of our local representatives with us, but both Patty Comline, who represents Dorset, and Oliver Olson, who represents a district around Jamaica, Windhall, Londonderry, Weston, and Landgrove, weren't able to be with us today, but we're hopeful of having them in the near future. But anyway, we have the two of you today, so let's talk politics and what's going on up in Montpelier. You've been back up there at the State House now for about a month, and already it's been a fairly active session as far as I can see. But let's start off with, I guess, the question that probably preoccupies all of you legislators the most during that session. That's the question of the state budget. We've heard a lot of numbers get batted around about how big a deficit the state is running or would run. I think it started off at around the $75 million mark. That was reduced down to about 45 or 46 fairly quickly. Then we heard from a couple of your economists, Jeff Carr and Tom Cavett, say that revenue projections for the coming 6 months might be a little softer than they first thought. So, with all that, what is your take? Jeff, I'll start with you as a Ways and Means Committee member.
Sure.
Where are we at this point?
Well, where we're at right now is that the governor's budget recommendation has been submitted to the House Appropriations Committee, and they will do their due diligence and really get into the fine details, granular details of the budget, hey, looking at every line item and the whys and wherefores behind that. This is, you know, the fifth year of the great post-recessionary budgets, and it's difficult and has been difficult every year. We will see this year, as you indicated, initially there was a thought that the budget gap would be $75 million. There was some strengthening in revenues, so that was the estimate was brought down to $46 million. I think the governor, when he gave his budget address a couple weeks ago, pegged it around $50 million. But then we had the revenue estimate updates by Cavett and Carr, and they look at somewhat of a softening of revenues due to macro economy not really being as vital as we had hoped. And so that may go up another $9 million or so. The governor's instructions from his perspective in his budget address was no new broad-based taxes. I think once again you'll see some revisions on the spending side of the equation. But they are counting, meaning the administration, they're counting on some growth in revenues just due to a better economic situation. The House Committee on Appropriations has done a great job over the past 3 or 4 years dealing with this very daunting question. And I anticipate they'll do a good job again, a responsible, conscientious job.
And Cynthia, what's your take on that?
Well, I have been hearing that the fee bill is going to have like $10 million in fees in it. So that's one place.
What's the fee bill?
The fee bill is there are all kinds of fees in the state. There are permit fees. There are licensing fees if you have a certain profession.
Oh, okay.
There are all kinds of different. There are fees we pay to register our cars and all those kinds of. So there's a whole bunch of fees, and those are called user fees because you only pay it if you take that action. So I only pay the licensing fee to be an electrician if I am an electrician. If you're not, you don't pay that fee.
Right. Okay.
I only pay the registration fee on my car if I register my car. If I don't do that, I don't pay that fee. So what has happened since I've been on Montpelier is that governors who say, well, I'm not going to raise broad-based taxes, don't seem to have any kind of problem raising very narrowly based fees, which may or may not be a better way to go. But I think it's worth noting that, and Jeff can correct me if I'm wrong, but my understanding is that this is a really big fee bill. So they're going, that's one place they're going to get the money. The other place that I would go if I was looking for money would be a category called tax expenditures. And the tax expenditures are everything that gives someone an exemption from paying the regular tax rate. So it includes all kinds of tax credits, deductions, exemptions from certain taxes, many of them things that we all support. But collectively, it's a lot of money. It's like $1 billion. And the whole state budget, excluding federal money, I think, is about $4 billion. So $1 billion is a lot. And the problem with this is that even as we've cut the budget over and over and over again, the cost of those tax expenditures has not been cut. Mm-hmm. They haven't been revised. And even if it's a program that we all support, like current use or income sensitivity or certain other kinds of exemptions or a credit for solar mm-hmm. panels or whatever, why should those policy goals be exempt from the same kind of scrutiny and shaving that we have to do elsewhere? So the Ways and Means Committee has been looking at this for years and trying to figure out a way to get at it. Mm-hmm. But to my knowledge, they haven't really figured it out, because each of those credits has a very loyal constituency. Mm. So I'm not sure the best way to get at it, but I just think it's worth noting to people that there's this whole area of sort of, if you think of taxes flowing like this into funding state government, some of it gets diverted, and how that diversion goes doesn't have the same scrutiny that the regular expenditure. Mm-hmm. So again, I'm not questioning the validity of those purposes. I'm just saying that it's almost like a shadow budget mm-hmm. or a ghost budget. And I don't think we can afford to do that anymore. So I would have liked to see Ways and Means do more scrutiny of tax expenditures, maybe sunset some of them, maybe cap the cost. Just cap the cost, because right now you set up a tax expenditure and whoever qualifies for it gets it, and you don't know how much it's going
to
cost.
Just to clarify, a tax expenditure is basically like a tax credit or
yes,
a subsidy of some sort.
It's a credit, and many of them are ones that we're very fond of, you know, like the mortgage interest deduction.
Yeah.
I mean, I'm not, you know, I mean, there's a lot of things in play here, but it doesn't make sense to me to say that, you know, you're going to cut aid to needy families over and over and over again, and you're never going to look at this category of mm-hmm. what are called tax expenditures. Mm-hmm. So I just want to highlight that for people, because if we're in the business of transparency and accountability, that flow needs to be accounted for. And again, the House Ways and Means has looked at this over and over and over again, and I think the problem is that the Senate, you know, doesn't quite get it. I could be wrong.
The bad guys in the other house.
Yeah. I call it the secondary chamber.
Right. But, the junior chamber.
And then there was something. Could I just say one other thing about the budget?
Sure.
Last year, we undertook this little scenario with the property tax and how, and the education fund, and how the contribution from the general fund to the education fund is calculated, and we essentially rebased how that's calculated. And that means that this year, less money will go into the ed fund from the general mm-hmm. fund than otherwise would have. And this has been documented by Vermont League of Cities and Towns, Public Assets, and Representative Olson. I'm not making
right.
this up. And what bothers me is that the governor keeps saying, I'm not going to raise broad-based taxes. And yet, in my opinion, the actions taken last year put upward pressure on property taxes. And that's a broad-based tax as far as I'm concerned.
Mm-hmm.
And he's not wrong that local school boards have to keep their costs under control. They do. They have that responsibility. But I think it's disingenuous to keep saying, I'm not going to raise broad-based taxes, when you took steps that put upward pressure on the property taxes for all school districts, even those that are controlling their budgets.
Well, it's unfortunate that Oliver isn't here with us, because I know he played a large role in
he
calling this to everyone's attention.
He did, but just because he's not here, I just still want
right.
to mention that.
Well, let's skip ahead then, if we may, because this was one area I was thinking about covering later, was the whole property taxes and the rate on the education fund and how that all worked. I mean, do you guys see, or do you consider it realistic for local school boards, who have been really tightening their belts for a couple of years now, if not longer, are you going to be able to hold the line on spending again this year? And how does that, does it indeed look as if local property taxes for education will be facing a lot of upward pressure? Does that seem plausible?
Well, when you say hold the line, I think it is probably improbable that they'll be able to have a 0% increase from what we've seen so far. We had tests.
Those are pretty rare anyway.
Yeah. Well, they did. I think school districts did a wonderful job over the last couple of years.
Yeah.
But there is some pent-up demand, I gather, and they still have some pressures, budgetary pressures they must deal with. And different school boards are coming in at different levels. But, make a long story short, we had testimony last Friday in Ways and Means on this very question, And with about a third of the towns reporting what their recommendations are going to be in reference to school budgets, it looks like they're coming in on average at 2.5% above last year. So if that increase is something that the voters eventually approve and it plays out in all the towns, yeah, there'll be some upward pressure on property taxes. That in concert with a grand list that is going down. So we have a tax base that's is reduced over what it was in the past because of, you know, the drop in values of property, with some upward spending pressure. And when you put those two together, you'd see a tax rate increase.
Okay. Well, I'm sure we'll stay tuned, because this will be an issue. I'm sure we'll get highlighted a lot in March town meeting, which is right around the corner, and further on down the road from there. Let's talk a little bit about health care. Last year was one of the major legislative accomplishments of the then-new Shumlin administration, a major bill which anticipates, I know that it's not really technically a single-payer health plan, at least not yet, but moving in that direction by, I think, 2017, I suppose, would be the target. But right now, things seem to be, from this standpoint, in a bit of a holding pattern, I guess. We now have a five-member Green Mountain Care Board established, which I gather is doing a lot of research on how this will all work. And, of course, the big $64 million, or maybe it's a larger number than that, question is how much will it cost, and will it be less expensive than whatever the system we have going on now. Cynthia, I know you've been outspoken on the subject, and I guess I wanted to hear what you thought about where things stood now. And I guess one question in particular I'd like to find out is, why will the legislature get to hear anything about this before, let's say, this time next year? I gather they're not going to make a report until January of 2013.
Well, first of all, I think the legislature is going to get various reports during the session and during the year on things, for instance, malpractice reform. I think there's a report on tort reform due to the legislature like today, so we'll have to see how those reports play out. But I think the thing that most people are concerned about is how much is this going to cost, and that's related to the benefit package, and how will we finance it, you know, with what taxes or federal money or whatever. And those two big questions are not going to be answered until after the election. And that's always been a problem for some of us in terms of trying to know exactly what we're doing before we start doing it. I have introduced a bill that would require a study by the Joint Fiscal Office, which is the legislature's nonpartisan research arm, to ask them to study what this program might cost and how we might financing different scenarios for financing it, using the state employees insurance package as a proxy for whatever we ultimately have. Because I understand if the Green Mountain Care Board says they can't come up with their final recommendations until later, but I think it's imperative that the legislature have more information and analysis sooner, and I think it's imperative that the voters do. I have no ideological objection to the concept of a fewer payer plan. But to me, it's very important to know how you're going to pay for it. You create this giant entitlement and it's not properly financed, it's a disaster. Legislatures have a tendency to be really generous with benefits, and they don't really like to put in sufficient financing because that involves taxes. So I'm very concerned about that kind of transparency. So my bill, I mean, the other problem is there's so much uncertainty here. We're going to try to do the health benefits exchange required by the federal law, and yet we know the federal law is actually under challenge right now in the Supreme Court. So that could conceivably go away.
Yeah.
We know that even if we have the health benefits exchange, can we be sure that the federal funding for the tax credits that are the main point of having that exchange to help people buy insurance, can we be sure that money will be there? Then if we don't have that and the federal money goes away, how will we finance Green Mountain Care? So there's a whole sequence of uncertainties and decision points. It makes it very difficult to know what to do. And one of my big problems is that up until this point in time, the uninsured in Vermont and the underinsured, people who don't really have enough health insurance, they haven't really been helped by anything that we've done. And another thing that my bill does is it creates a loan program so that if you're uninsured or underinsured in Vermont and you incur catastrophic medical debt, you could get a loan from the state and then repay it so that you wouldn't have to declare bankruptcy. Because I think it's outrageous that we're doing all this in the name of those Vermonters and yet we haven't actually done anything to help them. It's important to note that if the health benefits exchange with the tax credits comes into place, many of the underinsured will be able to purchase better coverage more affordably. The uninsured will also be helped. The uninsured in Vermont right now, I think it's about 42,000 people. Half of them are already eligible for Medicaid or Catamount or Medicare. They're just not enrolled. Mm-hmm. So we need to do a better job of enrolling them. The other half will be helped by those tax credits. And if those tax credits don't come forward, we can help those people in another way. I guess I sort of feel sometimes that we're contemplating overhauling everything and providing state insurance to solve a problem that we could solve with more modest steps. Mm-hmm. And I'm very concerned that the way the board is going at the health benefits exchange is going to narrow down the choices for businesses and for how they provide health insurance. And my bill loosens that up again. It's built on Senator Luzzi's bill. He did a bill in the Senate.
Well, Jeff, your take on the healthcare situation, well, this is a wait and see. I mean, I know you participated in a panel last year at the Maple Street School, and with this question came up.
Right.
We're still basically kind of waiting to hear a little bit more definitive information as to where things are going to stand, or...
Well, I think Cynthia is right. There are a lot of uncertainties out there. And I have a problem with the current timeline. Because the timeline that we approved in, I think it was Act 48, that assumed that we might be able to get a waiver from the federal government, which allowed for any new system, whether it be single payer, whatever system we come up with, to be implemented in 2014. It appears that that simply is not going to happen. So my perspective is, because of the uncertainties we have associated with the federal law itself and whether it's going to remain because it's of the appeals to the Supreme Court, and due to the potential funding issues associated with the federal government and where funding is going to come from or if there's going to be scale back funding in the future, I would suggest that instead of trying to design the program now and recommend a funding source now, that we push the whole timeline back, one that recognizes that 2017 is the earliest we could ramp it up, and then look at designing that program between now and say 2015, and once the program is designed and once a feasible program is at least put on the drawing board, then take a good hard look at financing. I think to do it now, to try to force it now with some type of artificial 2014 timeline in mind doesn't make sense at all. And try to have a financing plan in place in 2013 for something that won't take effect until 2017, it doesn't make sense to me. I think we should push everything back, recognize that the 2017 date is the really relevant date at this point in time, and work back from there.
Mm-hmm. Well, I don't envy either of you or any of your colleagues up in Montpelier wrestling with this problem. It's a real thorny, complicated issue, and one where I'm sure probably half the state's going to be mad at you no matter what you do. But
sure.
That's why they pay you the big bucks to do this job, right?
Yeah.
Well, let's move on. There's so many areas to cover here, limited amount of time, but one of the areas where there seems to be a lot of activity, and this is not unusual, is the whole energy sector. I mean, we recently had the big decision coming down from the federal judge in Brattleboro about Entergy, and perhaps we can talk about that a little bit. Where you see that going, Governor Shumlin also introduced a rather ambitious and very long-range energy plan for the state, which anticipates having 90% of the state's energy coming from renewable sources by 2050. That's a long way down the road, but you know, I suppose 1 year leads to another pretty quickly. But there are two other situations that I think maybe have somewhat more local resonance, perhaps, that I wanted to ask you about. And I'll start with you, Cynthia, on this question about the CVPS Green Mountain Power merger. As many viewers will know, the state's two largest utilities are looking to merge. GMP is looking to acquire CVPS. GMP is also partially owned, I believe, by a Canadian company, Gaz Metro. And then there's the whole question of the state's transmission lines, the Velco part of it. But I noticed, Cynthia, last week that you were not exactly a big fan of this merger, and I wondered if you could tell us a little bit about why you're, what your concerns are about that, and what do you think they should do instead?
No, I have a lot of reservations about this merger. I think that it's important to know that when you have a situation of monopoly power, and the newly merged Green Mountain Power, which combines Green Mountain Power and CVPS, will have 70% or 80% of the distribution electricity in the state. When you have that situation, in order to get a good result for customers, you have to either have a tightly and flexibly regulated private monopoly or a public monopoly, which would be a whole other thing. It would be, you know, public controlling electricity. So what we're looking at is, can we regulate this newly merged entity properly? And you are correct. Green Mountain Power is owned by Gaz Métro, so essentially Gaz Métro, a Quebec corporation, is taking over CVPS and merging them. And I'm very concerned about that, not because I have anything against Canada or Gaz Métro at all. I'm concerned about what might happen in the future. What if the new Green Mountain Power was sold to another entity, because it could be sold to a sovereign corporation for Dubai? Mm-hmm. And what sort of checks would we have on that? I believe the Public Service Board has some ability to evaluate transfers and acquisitions, but I'm not sure how much ability they have to reject them or to put conditions on them. So I want to try to strengthen that regulatory ability. I'm very concerned about the transmission lines. I can think of only two really good reasons why anyone would want to have control of electricity in Vermont. And one is because our regulatory structure makes it too easy to get rate increases. This is something that was put in place 8 or 10 years ago, and I'd like to reverse that. And the second is, Canada wants to get its power down to Connecticut and New York. So they would like to be able to get, to have Vermont as one way to do that. We know we've heard a lot of discussion about a line going through New Hampshire, but that's the only other reason that anybody would want this. And I'm concerned that at some point in the future, you could have Gaz Métro putting pressure on the state to use the state's power of eminent domain to force sales of private property to get a transmission line for a private entity. I mean, the state's power of eminent domain is like one of the ultimate powers, and it should be only used, you know, mm-hmm. if you're trying to build an interstate, you have to do it. People are always compensated for the sale, but sometimes they're forced into unwilling sales.
Okay. So I'm going to have to stop you right there, Cynthia, because I have to keep my eye on the clock a little bit here. But Jeff, do you have any feelings on this merger, good, bad, and different? Is it?
Yeah, other than as it relates to the Velco power lines, mm-hmm. and I think that is an important issue that we have to focus on. Other than that, I'm not particularly bothered by it. I mean, mm-hmm. electric utilities are highly regulated. The Public Service Board has a lot of authority in regulating and overseeing and monitoring electric utilities. So I think it could be good in the sense that it creates some efficiencies. I think many folks have come forward and embraced the idea, mm-hmm. and I think there could be some benefit to ratepayers and others in this merger. So I'm not at this point opposed to it, and view it favorably.
Mm-hmm.
Could I follow up on that?
Sure.
Because there was just an article in the Rutland Herald yesterday that indicates that the savings that GMP is forecasting, they're going to take a whole lot more of those savings than they're going to give to ratepayers. Mm-hmm. And the regulatory power of the Public Service Board is dependent on the statutory structure that the legislature puts in place. So what has sometimes happened in other states is the regulated industry kind of captures the agency, and if the agency disobeys and puts in place regulations that the industry doesn't like, then the next election season, the industry tries to elect people that will favor their regulatory changes. So I agree with Jeff. I have nothing against the Public Service Board, very smart, well-intentioned people. But you just need to understand that this is not going to be regulating a big in-state corporation. This is going to be regulating a giant corporation that's out of state. We don't even know which corporation it will be. It might not be Gaz Métro.
So you want to write language into
the
thing,
saying,
hey, I want
to strengthen the power. Yes, I want to put
what we can do.
That's right. And so my bill actually requires legislative approval of the merger, and I know that's unlikely to fly, but I was really trying to say, wait a minute, because there's just been, this is what, things just slide through the Public Service Board without enough scrutiny, like the smart meters, mm-hmm. because it's like this little club and nobody really knows what's going on. It's really hard for the public to participate. And the decision comes out and you're like, wait a minute, where'd that rate increase come from? Wait a minute, what about these smart meters? So, you know, it gets a little too cozy sometimes in that regulatory process, okay. and I would like to try to lean the other way.
Well, since you mentioned smart meters, Cynthia, perfect segue into the next thing I want to talk about, and I think we're going to need a few extra minutes here to hack our way through all of these. Smart meters, smart grid, been touted as one of the ways we're going to wind up saving money and also help electric utilities regulate the use of electricity. They'll be able to tell when there's an outage somewhere in real time, rather than waiting for someone to call them in at 6 o'clock in the morning or whatever. Well, Jeff, let me start off with you, just to keep the flow going here. What do you think about the smart meter question? I gather it certainly drew some controversy locally here in town. There's a group of folks that definitely didn't seem enamored with the idea. I'd be surprised if it doesn't come up in town meeting at some point or another. Do you have any concerns about, radiation and privacy are two areas that I can think of that people seem to be worried about?
Well, the whole thesis behind smart meters is to allow the ratepayer, the consumer, to better manage their power use, which I think is a great thing. And it gives the utility, in our case CVPS, faster response time mm-hmm. when there are problems. There has been some pushback by some folks. I think the Public Service Board and the Public Service Department has listened to that. And there is an opt-out opportunity for people who don't want smart meters mm-hmm. to opt out of that arrangement. I think in toto, unless there's some evidence that I can be given that suggests there are indeed some documented health issues associated with smart meters, I think in all, they are a mm-hmm. step forward, a sound step forward. Commissioner of Health, Harry Chin, testified last week and indicated from his perspective and what he's been able to find out that there is no adverse impact on mm-hmm. health. So given what I know now, given what the commissioner has said, I think it's a smart thing to go with a smart meter.
Okay.
I might pay for that politically, but I think it's a wise move.
Yeah, they certainly sound quite interesting. Cynthia, I gather you have more
concerns. Well, I don't have a problem with the basic concept and when it's being done on a hardwired basis.
Mm-hmm.
I think that for many people, the idea of the extra radio frequency waves from the box on the houses is really bothering them.
So this is where basically the information from your home, your electric
yes,
use, is going to be sent via a wireless
modem,
inside the smart meter.
And I think that the hardwired version would have been much more reliable. I don't think CVPS will even be able to do the box thing once they get out in Sandgate and Arlington. So they might as well. They're going to have to do it hardwired or some other way out there anyway. But I think that what bothers me the most about it is that the opt-out provision right now, you have to pay extra to opt out.
$10 a month.
And you have to take an extra action to opt out. My understanding from discussing things with people in Montpelier is that the board may get rid of the opt-out fee, which would be a huge thing. Mm-hmm. And I think that is the single most important thing to make it easier for people to take this, because then they know that if for whatever reason, whether it's based on unfounded fears or whatever, if they don't want it on their house, they don't have to have it. And I think people should be allowed to opt out without the fee. So if they do that, that will go a long way to reconcile me to this. But I would like to point out again that this has been going through the process. I thought it was all going to be hardwired, and I'm kind of wired in, and I didn't understand what was happening, and now it gets out in the public. This was approved by the Public Service Board, and the problem is there isn't enough communication. There isn't enough public involvement of these decisions. This is an example, a very small one, of why we need to keep track of what the regulators are doing.
Mm-hmm.
So as long as they get rid of the opt-out fee, you know, I wouldn't fight this. I agree with Jeff that there can be big benefits, mostly, I think, for big industrial users, because I'm sorry, no matter what they do with the prices of electricity, I'm not going to get up in the middle of the night to do my laundry. So
I might.
You might, yeah. Anyway. So I think that the I did hear from someone who, with some credibility, that most likely they're going to get rid of the opt-out fee.
All right. Well.
So that would go a long way towards resolving this problem.
All right. I heard the same thing.
Yeah.
Okay. Well, that would be interesting to see. I know from one forum I went to a couple of months ago in Manchester, it sounded like that opt-out fee, the $10 a month thing, was kind of an important part of the package for CVPS.
Right.
A representative there said, well, you know, we kind of need that to make this thing financially viable, but
And yet they say the whole thing's going to lower their cost. If it's really going to lower their cost, then you'd think they could have,
capacity.
And this just shows you how the money things and what costs what is like gets played around with up there.
Okay, let's go back to Entergy rather than Energy. The judge in the case there that the state brought against Entergy, or maybe it was Entergy against Vermont, about closing down the plant in March of this year, basically seemed to tell the state that, hey, you know, it's, you don't really have the law that was passed in 2006, I think it was, Act 153, was it? No. But whatever the act was that gave the state overview over Entergy's license, you know, it's kind of up to the Public Service Board, I guess. So let's assume that for whatever reason the state decides not to appeal this decision. I'm sure that discussion is going on very intensively up in Montpelier, but let's assume that Attorney General Sorrell and Governor Shumlin decide that that's probably not likely to yield a positive result. What options are open then to the legislature? Can you essentially tax Entergy out of business or make it very expensive for them to be there, either by putting a tax on casks, the dry cask storage, or using some other method to make life more difficult for Entergy Corporation than they would like to have it?
That should be our goal, to make it more difficult?
Oh, I don't know. But I've heard that mentioned as one possible kind of fallback plan.
Yeah.
Should the legal route...
Well, my goal is not to make life more difficult for Entergy. Entergy, at this point, has proven through the court process that federal law trumps state law, that state is preempted, I guess, from licensing the way we have done it through the legislature. And now it'll be up to the Public Service Board to take a look at it going forward. So we have that process that we'll move forward. But whatever we do with Entergy, I think we should treat them like any other entity in the state and be fair and reasonable. That's not to say that we absolve them of all fees and taxes. They are somewhat of a special case in the sense that they do have, they're storing radioactive waste on site. But if we do impose a fee, if we do impose taxes going forward, those should be fair and reasonable. And that's my position, simple as that.
Okay. Anything you wanted to add to that, Cynthia?
I would pretty much echo what Jeff said. I would say that you know, Entergy has pretty powerfully asserted its right to do business and to keep the licensing issues, the safety issues, out of the state and in the Nuclear Regulatory Commission and the regulation in the Public Service Board. But if I could say anything to Entergy, I would say, all right, you've asserted your right. Now you have to live up to your responsibilities, because with every right comes a responsibility, and people always are more eager to assert their rights than they are to accept their responsibilities. So Entergy has a responsibility to be transparent and accountable in terms of the effects of its operations on the environment, to take responsibility for funding the ultimate cleanup, whenever that is going to be, and to deal with the dry cask storage issues. And I think that I have heard discussions of what kind of taxes or whatever. I understand there may be an impulse to be punitive, but I would share Jeff's idea that we have to be responsible too. We may have a right to tax them, but we have to do it in a responsible way.
Mm-hmm.
So I personally would have liked to see some kind of compromise where the plant might have gone on for another 5 years or 10 years instead of 20 years, but it doesn't seem as if that's an option within the federal regulatory process. I never had to vote on this issue. I really don't know how I would have voted, but that would have been one thing that I would have been looking toward.
Mm. Okay, well, just to kind of wrap things up, this is also a redistricting year. And based on the U.S. Census, we're redividing and realigning a lot of legislative districts around the state. Jeff, I guess you're fairly safe that Manchester is going to remain a one district town, more or less, as is. But over in your district, Cynthia, I guess there's some discussion around the idea of the town of Stratton joining your district. Where does that stand? Is that kind of a pretty much of a done deal at this point, or is it still a discussion point? And if so, what happens to West Rupert? Are they going to go someplace else?
Okay, I can give you the situation as it stands right now, but first let me just give a little background. The Bennington 5 district, which is right now Arlington, Sandgate, Sunderland, and a little bit of West Rupert, we gained population, but of course Chittenden County gained a whole lot more. So my district is short people right now. The Shaftesbury-Glastonbury district, just south of me, is short more people than I'm short. So Shaftesbury really has a problem, okay? So what's essentially happening is that almost all the other districts around us are staying the same, mm-hmm. but they are, the Government Operations Committee in the House has basically proposed solving the problems of both the Shaftesbury district and what I will call the Arlington district by changing the Arlington district. And they are going to keep the corner of West Rupert, add Stratton, and then there would be two things that could happen. Either all of those towns plus Shaftesbury and Glastonbury would become one giant two-member district with two members elected at large, or a line could be drawn to divide it in two single-member districts. But that would mean that some voters, some people would have to be taken from Arlington or Sunderland, about 150, to be added to the Shaftesbury district. So the Government Operations Committee, as my understanding right now, is going to leave it to the Board of Civil Authorities of those towns to decide, do they want to be one giant two-member? And this is giant, remembering that right now, especially courtesy Irene, there is no way for me to get to Stratton from inside my district. I got to go through his district. So, so it's a really big district. Okay.
Right.
Now, I will do my best to represent anyone who I might happen mm-hmm. to be able to earn their vote. So I don't have a problem with representing anybody. But it became this really difficult thing up there for me where the committee was saying, well, can you live with this? Can you live with this? What's better? What's better? And I'm not the one that should make this decision. This is not about me. It's about the towns and what do the boards of civil authority want. So I actually think that although this is not a framework that I would have wanted, I think that Stratton probably belongs with the towns on the other side. You know, I would have preferred to solve Arlington's problems in a different way and not to try to solve Shaftesbury's problems in Arlington. You know, I mean, they're essentially solving all the problems in my district. You know, that's kind of hard. You know, so I would not have preferred anything about this, but I think it's best for the boards of civil authority to make the decisions within the framework that the committee is given, rather than them constantly asking representatives, what do you want? It's not about me. So that's where it stands now. And, you know, I do want to make the point that historically, when Shaftesbury has been short of people, the problem has been solved by taking a little bit from North Bennington, where there are really close ties of the school and the shopping and everything like that. And this year, that was just seen as completely off limits. They wouldn't even consider that for whatever political
hot button down there.
Yeah.
And I guess I better have Alice Miller on the show next time, huh?
All right.
I hear her side of it. Well, just a final question then throw out to both of you. Are there any bills in particular that both of you are working on or either of you are working on that you wanted to mention that you felt perhaps pertained to some local issue here that you just wanted to make some of the viewers aware of? Anything in particular or particular issues that you really feel you're going to be spending some time on?
Well, I mean, both Cynthia and I have filed a number of bills, but in a couple of the minor, I guess the ones that are maybe of interest to Manchester, maybe related to better enforcement of civil ordinance, fine collections, things like that, sort of the nuts and bolts in town government, a bill that would split the cost of property appeals between the state and the municipality. Right now, the municipality has to pick up the full share, even though the state education tax, those monies go to the state. So there's legislation along those lines that I've filed, but also following very closely this whole issue in, that bubbled up through Manchester to the Supreme Court relative to tax bills and whether the income sensitivity adjustment should be public or private. Supreme Court has indicated that should be private information, and that's the law of the land now. But I think we'll see, it's still being percolating in various committees, but any change relative to that would come through my committee, House Ways and Means, and I think there's interest in keeping that information private. Mm-hmm. There's a few technical issues that have to be addressed about, you know, who will have access to the information inside local government and who won't. Such as auditors, you know, should will need to take a look at that information when they do the audit, you know, spot checking, you know, test cases. But I think we can work around those technical matters and devise a plan that keeps that information essentially private for most, mostly across the board, and still make it workable in the system that we currently have. Mm-hmm. So that's one thing that I know in my town a lot of folks are very interested
in. It's a fascinating case.
Yeah, it is.
It's been quite interesting to follow that through. Well, Cynthia, you get the last word. Any bills in particular that you want to highlight that you're involved in?
Well, I will say that I'm working on a tax reform bill, and I can see Jeff getting nervous. And and it's actually going to be related to this question of are we exercising good stewardship of the flows of the budget and these tax expenditures, and is there a way to pick up on the work of the Blue Ribbon Tax Commission and take it further? So it's really a conversation starter. I have no expectation that something so big will happen this year, but I want to keep people's eyes on this because I think this is a long-term issue that we can do better with both the budget and the tax system in Vermont. The other thing I just want to say is the governor's mental health plan. That is going to be in my committee tomorrow. Mm-hmm. We will be voting it out, and although I hope that the question of the mental hospital or anything is the furthest thing from anyone's minds or daily concerns, we need to be sure that we have a system in place to help Vermonters who need help. So I would encourage people to follow the press coverage of that plan as it moves forward.
Right. I mean, you remind me of something that we didn't really get a chance to talk about, the whole post-Irene adjustment and obviously the Waterbury complex up there, big part of that whole question as to how we move forward in the wake of
that. Back.
We'll have to have you guys back here in
happy to do it.
April or May or something like that and find out how it all turned out.
It'd be great. Good.
Well, thank you both for being here today. Jeff Wilson,
thank
representative
you.
From Manchester, Cynthia Browning, representative from Arlington, Sunderland, Sandgate, and West Rupert.
And who knows what else?
And maybe Stratton. Who knows?
Right.
We'll see. And anyway, thank all of you for watching. This has been The Front Page on GNET. My name is Andrew McKeever. It's been a pleasure being with you today, and we'll see you the next time around.